Notes, cue cards, or what? There are many theories that abound in this category with regards to delivering your speech. No one way is better than another, but there are some considerations we would be remiss if we did not tell you about. After all, you want to give a great speech. Knowing your material is the most important part. Earlier, we told you that you really need to have a full written copy of your entire speech. This is not so you can bring it to the stage with you and just read from it. This is mainly because that way you can see the structure and make changes as needed. But a full written copy also makes rehearsing it much easier. Ideally, the best way to give a speech is by memorizing it and then allowing your personality to shine through during delivery. So that's the ideal way to do it. However, human beings can make mistakes, and there's nothing worse than being in the middle of a speech and forgetting what part comes next. Professional speakers have honed the art of ad-lib, but you probably don't have the knack of it developed yet. If you decide to give your speech from memorization, be sure you know it backwards and forwards. Practice while brushing your teeth. Practice while driving to work. Heck, even practice while taking a shower. You have to know the speech inside and out, every comma, quotation mark, and period. Involve the help of a friend or member of your family and rehearse it in front of them. Stand in front of the mirror and rehearse with yourself. Take caution here, though. When you have your speech completely memorized, it's easy to slip into a rote delivery, one with absolutely no punch at all. It's almost the same as standing at the podium and reading the speech. Memorization can be difficult, however, and very risky, as we've said. So there are a couple of other techniques that can help you along the way. My favorite has always been note cards. You know, those little 3x5 or 4x6 white cards with blue lines that you get almost at any store. Yeah, those. I buy them by the carton because I use them for so many things, but for speeches, they're great also. Note cards are not a crutch. They're a way to help keep you on track and know what the next part of your speech is going to be. So if you're going to be using note cards, do not write your whole speech on them. Just write the main ideas, along with a few words to remind you of what you're going to say about those ideas. Your notes should consist of the key words or points of your speech, a skeleton of thoughts or words around which you can build your speech. You may refer to your notes occasionally to maintain the thread of your speech, while, for the most part, you'll be able to speak directly to the audience. Here's a valuable piece of advice as well. When you make your note cards, always make two copies. I remember an episode of The Brady Bunch where Mike Brady was to give a big speech and he couldn't find his note cards. This caused chaos in the family until they were finally found, and all was well. Typical Brady episode. If Mike had just made a second copy of those cards, such drama wouldn't have happened. But the show would have been awfully short, too. At any rate, make yourself an extra copy. Better to be safe than sorry. Oh, and keep those two sets in separate places. Maybe keeping one set at the office and one set at home would work for you. However you need to store them is fine. Just store them away from each other until the big day. After you've made these two sets of note cards, make a small hole in one corner using a hole punch. You can then tie all the cards together with string or whatever you want. That way you can turn the cards over as they're used, but should you drop them, you won't have to fumble around trying to pick them up and reorder them. The securing device does not have to be sophisticated as long as it's strong. When you have these notes in front of you, don't read from them. Just glance at them from time to time, such as when you need a memory boost. They are not a crutch. They are a memory aid, so use them as such. Another great tool to have when giving a speech is to prepare a PowerPoint presentation that the audience can look at and refer to while you're speaking. This can serve as a sort of teleprompter for you, or electronic notes, if you will. Plus, if you use a PowerPoint, you can jazz it up and make it captivating for your audience. So, you've got your speech, you've made up your note cards. Now let's look at how you can make your speech really great through your delivery. Speaking with flair. Delivery of your speech is what will make it interesting and captivating. 90% of speeches are boring and drab. Why? Because the speaker doesn't take time to make it interesting. You can have a wonderfully written presentation, but if you don't put some flair into the delivery, you'll be joining the ranks of boring speeches and boring speakers. Plus, you'll lose your audience's attention really quick. The goal of a speech is to entertain the audience while giving them information that they can really use. Focus on that during your delivery. This is show business, and if you treat it as such, you'll be a great speaker. Now, that doesn't mean that you want to stand on stage and do a two-step or jump around with excitement. What it means is speak with passion and believe in what you're saying. Your appearance can make all the difference in your confidence as a speaker. Think about the audience you will be presenting your speech to and dress like them. If they're wearing business attire, such as suits, you should wear a suit too. To underdress is to communicate the message, "I'm smarter, richer, more powerful than you. I can insult you and not take you seriously, and there's nothing you can do about it." This is hardly the way to get an audience to like you. Present the desired image to your audience. Look pleasant, enthusiastic, confident, proud, but not arrogant. Remain calm. Appear relaxed, even if you feel nervous. Speak slowly, enunciate clearly, and show appropriate emotion and feeling relating to your topic. While you're speaking, talk in a smooth, even tone. It's very common for beginning speakers to speak too quickly and too loudly. Make your pace conversational and don't rush it. Also, be sure to match your tone of voice with the subject matter. If it's a solemn topic, don't hoop and holler, but don't bring your audience down. Your job is to convey information in a way that they can understand and relate to. The best way to speak to your audience is through eye contact. The eyes have it. Eye contact is very important during a speech. When you establish eye contact with your audience, they will like you more and have the feeling that they are a part of your speech. Making eye contact can also make you more comfortable being the center of everyone's attention. Find a friendly face on each side of the room and look at them often. Mix up who you're looking at. You don't have to see everyone, but do make an effort. Use the 3-second method. For instance, look straight into the eyes of a person in the audience for 3 seconds at a time. Have direct eye contact with a number of people in the audience, and every now and then glance at the whole audience while speaking. Use your eye contact to make everyone in your audience feel involved. Eye contact is the cement that binds together speakers and their audiences. When you speak, your eyes involve your listeners in your presentation. There's no surer way to break a communication bond between you and the audience than by failing to look at your listeners. No matter how large your audience may be, each listener wants to feel that you are talking to him or her. The adage, "the eyes are the mirror of the soul," underlines the need for you to convince people with your eyes as well as your words. Only by looking at your listeners as individuals can you convince them that you are sincere and are interested in them, and that you care whether they accept your message. When you speak, your eyes also function as a control device you can use to assure your listeners' attentiveness and concentration. Eye contact can also help you to overcome nervousness by making your audience a known quantity. Effective eye contact is an important feedback device that makes the speaking situation a two-way communications process. By looking at your audience, you can determine how they are reacting. When you develop the ability to gauge the audience's reactions and adjust your presentation accordingly, you will be a much more effective speaker. How can you use your eyes most effectively? Consider the following. Know your material. Know it so well that you don't have to devote your mental energy to the task of remembering the sequence of ideas and words. You should prepare well, remember to use the 9 P's, and rehearse enough so that you don't have to depend heavily on notes. Many speakers, no matter how well prepared, need at least a few notes to deliver their message. If you can speak effectively without notes, by all means do so. But if you must use notes, that's fine. Just don't let them be a substitute for preparation and rehearsal. Even many experienced speakers use notes. Often they take advantage of such natural pauses as audience laughter or the aftermath of an important point to glance briefly at their notes. To make this technique work, keep your notes brief. See Chapter 6 for more on this topic. Establish a personal bond with listeners. How do you do this? Begin by selecting one person and talking to him or her personally. Maintain eye contact with that person long enough to establish a visual bond, about 5 to 10 seconds. This is usually the equivalent of a sentence or a thought. Then, shift your gaze to another person. In a small group, this is relatively easy to do, but if you're addressing hundreds or thousands of people, it's impossible. What you can do is pick out one or two individuals in each section of the room and establish personal bonds with them. Then each listener will get the impression you're talking directly to him or her. Monitor visual feedback. While you're talking, your listeners are responding with their own nonverbal messages. Use your eyes to actively seek out this valuable feedback. If individuals aren't looking at you, they may not be listening either. Their reasons may include one or more of these factors. They may not be able to hear you. Solution: if you're not using a microphone, speak louder and note if that works. They may be bored. Use some humor. Increase your vocal variety or add powerful gestures or body movements. They may be puzzled. Repeat and/or rephrase what you have just said. They seem to be fidgeting nervously. Solution: you may be using distracting mannerisms. Maybe you have food on your clothes, or worse, maybe your blouse is unbuttoned or your fly isn't closed. Make sure you are aware of these embarrassing possibilities before and during your speech. If necessary, try to correct them without bringing more attention to them. On the other hand, if your listeners' faces indicate pleasure, interest, and close attention, don't change a thing. You're doing a great job. You need to pay attention to how you're talking just as much as what you're saying. How to speak. Speak to the person farthest away from you to ensure your voice is loud enough to project to the back of the room. Vary the tone of your voice and dramatize if necessary. If a microphone is available, adjust and adapt your voice accordingly. As we've already noted, body language is important. Standing, walking, or moving about with appropriate hand gestures or facial expressions is preferred to sitting down or standing still with head down and reading from a prepared speech. Speak to your audience. Listen to their questions. Respond to their reactions. Adjust and adapt. If what you have prepared is obviously not getting across to your audience, change your strategy midstream if you're well prepared to do so. Remember that communication is the key to a successful presentation. If you're short of time, know what can be safely left out. If you have extra time, know what could be effectively added. Always be prepared for the unexpected. Pause. Allow yourself and your audience a little time to reflect and think. Don't race through your presentation and leave your audience, as well as yourself, feeling out of breath. Know when to stop talking. Use a timer or the microwave oven clock to time your presentation when preparing it at home. Just as you don't use unnecessary words in your written paper, you don't bore your audience with repetitious or unnecessary words in your oral presentation. To end your presentation, summarize your main points in the same way as you normally do in the conclusion of a written paper. Remember, however, that there is a difference between spoken words appropriate for the ear and formally written words intended for reading. Terminate your presentation with an interesting remark or an appropriate punchline. Leave your listeners with a positive impression and a sense of completion. Do not belabor your closing remarks. Thank your audience and sit down. Seek audience participation. Once a rapport has been established with a crowd, keep the connections going by peppering the talk with more audience interaction. By engaging the audience, they automatically become more vested in what you are saying because they're a part of it. Take it easy. It's worth noting that even the well-prepared can face an attack of the nerves when the big moment arrives to take the stage. To alleviate anxiety, forget the oft-repeated advice to picture the audience naked. The best advice to cure tension is to mingle with the audience and spot a friendly face in the crowd, preferably one that will beam and nod at the speaker during the presentation. professional speakers call these positive listeners. If it's impossible to get to know the audience ahead of time, or if the crowd is small, try to plant a few friends or colleagues in the audience. Glancing at them can help a speaker feel energized during rough spots in the presentation. Show enthusiasm. When the presentation starts, don't be afraid to let some passion shine through. In fact, this can make your speech more memorable than you ever thought possible. Speakers are often at their best when talking about a subject they care deeply about that's very important to them. In addition to passion, don't forget to make eye contact, he advises, and never forget to smile. Realize that people want you to succeed. Audiences want you to be interesting, stimulating, and informative. They don't want you to fail. The audience is on your side. They came to hear what you have to say. They are spending their time and perhaps money to be there, and they are predisposed to like you. Don't assume they are waiting for you to fail. They aren't. Don't apologize. If you mention your nervousness or apologize for any problems you think you have with your speech, you may be calling the audience's attention to something they hadn't noticed. Avoid pointing out your own imagined inadequacies. Your audience has a higher opinion of you than you think. Go ahead and get emotional. If your stuff doesn't move you, it won't move anyone else either. This is an immutable rule of presentation. If you are singing your interpretation of Twinkle, Twinkle, Little Star, pour yourself into it. If you are speaking about the nocturnal habits of fire ants, do it with gesticulations, reverberations, and tremors. Ridiculous, you say? Think again. When you get wrapped up in your speech and show it through your delivery, even when you think your performance isn't your best, your audience will. Get personal with the audience. This is far more than good advice. It is a rule that, if ignored, will become the difference between success and failure. You can give a perfect presentation, but without addressing the audience, you will probably not be remembered. You might know your topic and your speech backwards and forwards, but without acknowledging the people listening to you, you will likely be met with yawning and fidgeting. Give your speech the personal touch by showing your audience you care about them. You must get a rapport going with any audience on the personal level, or will get nothing else going at all. How can you do that? Take a cue from the stand-up comedian or the storyteller. They ask mundane questions, and they wait for someone to answer or acknowledge it with a gesture or murmur. Where are you from? Anyone here from New York? Hey, does it ever stop raining here in Washington? Let me see how many of you are here tonight. If you're here, raise your hand. For those of you that didn't raise your hand, I have a question. Where the heck are you? You can also employ a question and answer session near the end of your speech. Here are some tips for effective Q&A time. If you don't hear the question or understand it, ask the questioner to repeat it. Stay calm and pleasant. Remember that your ultimate goal is to teach the audience something they didn't know before. When they ask you a question, they are indicating that they want to know. Always respect the questioner, even if you do not like the question or the manner in which it was posed. Don't feel offended if someone asks you a question that you feel you already answered in your presentation or a previous question. They may have not heard or understood the information previously presented. Honesty is the best policy. If you don't know the answer to something, admit it. You can offer to get in contact with the person later with an answer. Don't panic if there are no questions to answer. Sometimes audiences feel that you've addressed all their questions and don't need additional information. That's good, believe me. It means your speech was effective. If there are no questions, simply close your speech and leave the stage. You can prompt your audience towards asking questions during a Q&A session. Change your wording. Ask, "What questions do you have?" rather than, "Do you have any questions?" When you use the word "what," you have changed the question from a closed-ended question to an open-ended question. This will automatically let the audience know that you assume they have questions to ask. Pause after you ask the question. Give folks time to think. The pause will also assure them that you really want them to ask a question. Be mindful of any conflicting body language, like looking at your watch or sorting your stack of notes after you have asked the question. This will give a mixed message. It will imply that although you have asked the audience for questions, you really do not have time to answer them. If all else fails, reward the person who asks the first question. Come prepared with an incentive to give people who ask a question during certain parts of your program. This works very well in the afternoons when more energy and interaction is demanded. Overall, if people know that you are sincere in your desire to respond to their questions, they will ask them. Give it a try. There's nothing more boring than a speaker who just stands there and recites what he or she has written. Movement and gestures. When delivering a speech, you must move around the stage. Don't just stand behind the podium. In fact, you may not even want to have a podium or stage with you. Removing the temptation will keep you from using it. Don't fidget and don't sway from side to side. Walk slowly, but with purpose. Gesturing with your hands is also good, but make them fit with your delivery. The audience will know if you're gesturing just to move your hands. Do it with purpose, but make sure it's natural. When it comes to gesturing, keep movements above the waist. Be slow, be varied, and by all means be accurate. Never hold up four fingers when you're giving three reasons. Don't be afraid to occasionally rest your arms. Gestures should never be applied. They should be spontaneous to reinforce the message. At times, rest arms by your side, and remember, practice makes perfect. Refine your gestures until they're second nature. Open up your arms to the size of the audience. Embrace your audience. Keep your arms between your waist and shoulders. When you're not using your arms, drop them at your side. If you can feel your fingertips at your thighs, that's a good measure of where your arms would be if you were not making an active point. Avoid quick and jerky gestures. They may make you appear nervous. Hold your gestures longer than you would in normal conversation. Vary gestures. Switch from hand to hand, and at other times, use both or no hands. Use gestures to reinforce a message or make a point. If making three points, don't hold up four fingers. Keep hands open and fingers together. Avoid pointing a finger, and fists may convey a threatening message. Vary your approach until you find what works best for you. Then use those gestures. Refine them until they come naturally to you, and add to them as you come across others that would work better or as well. As we've said, you need to move about the stage during your presentation. Why move in the first place? Moving forces people to focus and follow you. The way you walk from your seat to the speaker's position is very important. When you are introduced, you should appear eager to speak. Too many speakers look as though they are heading toward an execution, their own. Walk confidently from your seat to the lectern, if there is one. Pause there for a few seconds. Then move out from behind the lectern. As discussed before, it is wise to use the lectern as a point of departure and not a barrier to hide behind. Smile before you say your first words. Be careful not to stand too close or move beyond the people in the front row. Be careful not to walk too much. Doing so will work against you. Continuous pacing is distracting. Walking can be an effective way to stress an important idea. It is essential that your walk be purposeful and intentional, not just a random shift of position. Taking about three steps, moving at shallow angles, usually works best. When employing visual aids, you should use three positions. One position is your home position and should be front and center. The other two positions should be relatively near the home position. Never stand in front of any visual aid. When you practice your speaking, make sure you also practice your walking patterns. Try walking to and from your three positions. These positions should be planned just as your hand gestures are. When standing still, remember to maintain good posture. Stand up straight. Remember, it's not what you say, it's how you say it, and your body does speak very loudly. It's only when you marry your verbal message and your nonverbal message that a speaker begins to command presence. There actually is a wrong way to speak when delivering a speech. Broadcasting versus conversation. We've been influenced by the media to broadcast when we give a speech, to speak like a newscaster or a reporter. Now, this form of communication isn't bad in any way. It's just a style not suited for giving speeches. Giving speeches in a broadcast format is an instant turnoff to audience members. Why? Because they feel that they, as an individual, are not important. You are just broadcasting your message to the whole. In their eyes, you don't care about them as individuals. The majority of these people tend to go into broadcast mode when giving a speech, and the audience members groan inside thinking, "Not this type of speech again." When giving your speech, speak as if you were talking to a friend. This will give the impression that you are talking to each individual audience member on a very personal level. This will hold their interest in you and your speech because they feel you are talking to them personally. For example, let's say your speech is why berries are the best antioxidant fruits. Right before the first words come out of your mouth, when you give your speech, picture your best friend in the front row asking you, "Hey, you, why are berries the best antioxidant fruits?" Answer him like you would in the tone of a normal conversation in your speech and get that conversational tone effect. Also, make individual eye contact with one person while speaking in that conversational tone, and then move on to the next person and make eye contact with them, and repeat this process. This will further enhance your speech. To help you better understand the difference between broadcasting and the conversational tone, let's see what the opening lines of the same speech are like according to these two styles. Broadcasting. Numerous scientific studies have shown that berries contain a high level of antioxidants, more so than any other fruit. They attribute this unique quality to the... snooze. The audience shuts down mentally as they realize it's just another broadcast. Conversational. When I heard berries were the best antioxidant fruits, two questions came to mind. What the heck is an antioxidant, and why should I care about the berries that have them? I'll bet you thought that too. Well, I did a little research and came up with some answers. It seems an antioxidant is like a cancer-fighting machine. It's sort of like, well, the audience's ears perk up right from the start because they sense this is no ordinary broadcast speech. This speaker is talking to them on an individual level because of the conversational tone of the speech, so they listen accordingly. Trust me, the vast majority of people give speeches in broadcast mode. Remember your high school's valedictorian speech? They do this without even realizing it, and without knowing that it kind of shuts people's minds off the instant they detect it, unless they are really, really, really interested in what you have to say. Kill the broadcast. Open up the conversation and invite the audience in. Sometimes we may get so eager to get our message across that we speak faster than a high school girl sitting with her friends at a lunch table with the juiciest piece of gossip to hit the school in weeks. When you speak, let it land. Pause after each sentence. Let it sink in. Look at the audience to gauge whether you are speaking too fast. You know just as well as I do that if you have to keep up your comprehension with the speaker's fast rate of speech, you'll switch off and forget about it, as it is way too much work. Try using positive visualization. Yes, you've heard about this as well. Every book, teacher, and speaker recommends this practice, and you know why? It's because it works. Get a layout of the place where you're giving your speech. Stand on stage and picture the audience. Visualize yourself giving that one great speech, nailing it, and having the audience give you thunderous applause and genuine comments afterwards. Envision it constantly and feel the joy. Hear the applause. See yourself in your eyes giving the speech, feeling the confidence, laying out the simple points and examples, seeing their heads nod in understanding and agreement. You will find that your visualizations will come true. In fact, there are four basic aspects of public speaking that can help ensure your success. The four C's. Mastering the art of public speaking can be difficult, with a lot to learn in a seemingly never-ending list of do's and don'ts. But becoming a great speaker isn't all that difficult. Just adhere to the four C's. Confidence. Confidence is a state of mind which makes a person believe in himself or herself and at the same time respects others' abilities. When it comes to public speaking, confidence parts into two. The first one is your offstage confidence, which you have to develop. This can be developed with self-belief and support. There are other ways of doing this, like practice, which makes you feel confident. But self-belief is what sets the criterion. When you are in a competition or any place where you have to impress or excel anybody, your composure is the key. Listen to others' speeches, the ones you want to surpass. There may be some flaws in their speech that you can mend in yours. But don't let a good speech spoil your composure. Keep in mind an impression. This is good. Mine will be better. The next part is on-stage confidence. When you are on stage, your confidence is reflected on your face. Nervousness will settle in a matter of time. So don't consider nervousness as a major factor. In fact, you will feel nervous for the first 30 seconds or so of the speech, and then it will ebb. One way of gaining your stage confidence is you can realize the fact that the next few minutes belong to you, and whatever you say, everyone should listen. This would loosen up some nerves for sure. The other way is to think or see others as dolls. I would recommend this only if you're finding it very difficult to deliver a speech, because when you do so, it'll take away your fear of the people before you. But this only works for beginners, and also especially for late beginners who are afraid to speak before a mass. In normal, if you do so, you are not going to play with their minds, which is the essence of public speaking. Confidence can also be earned from friends who can appreciate you on your effort. Exaggeration, in this case, only leads to your improvement, so have friends who can encourage. Clarity. The second C is clarity. Again, this can be divided into two. One is the clarity in idea, and the other is clarity in speech. Of these two, the clarity of idea is more vital. You can say anything clearly, but your ideas must be distinct and simple. You can always borrow ideas from others, but they cannot be as good as your own ideas. Also, if you have a topic on hand, you must analyze that topic. Have a view from every angle. Try to be correct in all aspects. You should not give any wrong ideas or information to the listeners. Also, you must believe in your idea or point of view and involve in it. Your involvement will make the speech more attractive. There is no point in selecting a topic which you don't believe in and trying to talk for it. The next clarity is clarity of speech. Your invaluable ideas should be backed by your speech. Your tone must be commanding and modulated. Every sentence has its own effect on the listeners. Your aim is to get to the mind of your listeners. Powerful statements should be delivered powerfully. You must have the courage and character to express your thoughts on a particular topic. Powerful statements never fail to make an impact when they are delivered clearly and with perfect modulation. Apart from all these, your speech will be more effective if it is slow and steady. This gives the listeners the time to grasp your thoughts and digest them. Simplicity is another important thing. Keep your speech as simple as possible. It should reach everybody. Commitment. The next is the commitment you show towards your speech. It is not a relative aspect, but a broader one. It is not concerned about any particular speech. It's about your preparations for any speech. You have to listen to many speeches. By listening, I mean you should see the intricate details of another's speech, their modulation, use of language, humor, body language. Take off your shame if you have any. You should not be ashamed. Not everyone who is listening can deliver a speech. This view comes from the commitment that you show and the efforts you take. If possible, recite your speech in front of a mirror. It will work like a dream. Preparation is also a form of commitment that you show. It need not be paperwork only. It can be from your heart and brain duo also. But one advantage of having it on paper is that you will not miss any point. In some cases, missing a point can prove to be lethal. Next, dress yourself for the occasion. Your dressing will definitely reflect your confidence. Work on your style of speaking. You can change your modulation or your tone. You should be unique so that you can be identified by your tone itself. For this, the shortcut is practice, and practice hard. Command. The final C is to have a command over the language. Language is very important in public speaking. Command over a language can be acquired by reading books or seeing films. Command means familiarity of the language. This requires listening, observation, and use. Learn the different usage of the language. Learning as much as you can about every aspect of the language will help you a lot. Books will improve your vocabulary, while movies will improve your usage. Different words for the same essence should be in your mind. You should be able to dispatch command over language as easy and interesting as it is to acquire. You could add a fifth C in the form of comedy. A sense of humor can make you much more likable and make them look up to you. This will help them listen more intently to what you have to say. As we've said throughout this book, though, be sure that what you're saying is funny. Bad use of humor can cause you to bomb quickly. Now, let's look at an effective way for you to use your voice during your delivery. Finding the right voice. Speaking well can have a dramatic effect on your professional and private life. You may not realize how important the sound of your voice is, or how much you yourself judge other people by the way they sound. It is true that the impression you make on others often owes much more to how you speak, the pitch and expressiveness and clarity of your voice, for example, than to what you actually say. Some people say your voice is your voice and there's nothing you can do to change it. That's not necessarily true. You can practice speaking from your diaphragm and changing the intonation and inflection that comes naturally. If British actors can adapt an English accent, you can change your voice somewhat if you really try. Here are some things for you to consider while you're practicing your speech. Pay attention to them and implement them before speaking, so they come naturally. Posture. If your posture is poor, you will represent a poor image of yourself. Good posture is the natural alignment of the body. When sitting, you should be able to draw a straight line from ear to shoulder to the hip bone, and if you are standing, from the hip down to the knee. The act of clenching your fists can stifle your voice, so it is essential that you be calm and relaxed at all times. Control your breathing. Breath is the source of energy of voice and speech. A few don'ts. First, don't take a deep breath before starting a speech. Your instinct will be to hold your breath. Conversely, a voice underpowered by drawing too little breath would tend to come across as excessively quiet. Uncontrolled breathing can also affect your ability to communicate. Your message will pale beside the jerky style of your delivery. Well-controlled breathing can bring stress under control. Breathing exercises help develop your voice control. Pace, pause, and rhythm. The way you breathe adversely affects your pace and rhythm. By drawing in large amounts of oxygen into the lower half of your lungs, you will not need to pause for breath so often. Keep a steady flow of words. A continuous chatter or a slow, ponderous speech may be extremely annoying. Pausing at natural breaks, punctuation, for instance, will give you a moment to think about what you're going to say next. Intonation and emphasis. Every voice has a natural middle note. Some speakers pitch their voices too high or too low due to tension. Learn to identify and adapt your middle note. You will sound most natural. Practice using pitch to reflect the emotional content of your speech. The placing of an emphasis, the amount of stress put in a syllable, often affects the meaning of a sentence. For instance, bring down your hand only on words that need emphasizing. Caution yourself against exaggerated actions. Pronunciation. Faulty pronunciation stems more commonly from bad habits of the speech organs rather than malformations or malfunctioning. A person's accent, really a whole set of speaking habits, often marks him as a faulty speaker. There are many words having two or more pronunciations. Some people suffer a crisis of confidence when faced with the choice and instead switch to a different, often a far less appropriate word. In order to avoid this embarrassment, consult a good dictionary for guidance, and you can speak confidently the next time. Remember, only practice makes you perfect. Effective delivery. To make an impact on your audience, clear structure and well-judged content needs to be matched by effective delivery. Try to look at your audience most of the time. good speakers always communicate an element of spontaneity. Use short sentences and simple language. Check that you are making your points crisply. Make a tape of yourself giving your speech and listen to it critically. Make notes of where you can change your voice to better get your point across and pencil that into your notes. Tape recording your speech can also help you identify weak spots and places where you may need improvement. Now, we know that most people hate the sound of their voices on tape recordings, but remember that we hear our own voices differently than other people do. Just look for the places where you can improve rather than concentrating on the whole picture. Pick out pieces, and the whole will come together quite nicely. Many times, audiences will listen to the first 2 or 3 minutes of your speech before deciding whether or not they want to listen further. It's sad, but it's true. That's why first impressions are so important. Making a good first impression. The old saying goes, you only get one chance to make a first impression. Well, this is very true. People judge each other on what they see first, no matter what. Yes, you can possibly still win them over, but you'll have to try harder. And why would you want to do that? Start out with a bang and win over your audience from your first word. How do you do that? It's not as difficult as you think. We've already touched on your appearance, but this is the most deciding factor audiences look at because it's the first thing they see. You'll want your appearance to be the very best it can be. As we've said, dress like your audience. Make sure your clothing is tasteful and understated. You want them to concentrate on what you have to say, not what you're wearing. Avoid overly bright colors and excessive jewelry. They will draw attention away from your speech and will be distracting to the audience. Avoid jewelry that might make noise when you move. Also, be sure your pockets are empty of items that might be distracting. Be sure your clothing is clean and pressed with no wrinkles. I have been to several speeches where there was something minuscule wrong with the speaker's clothes, and I found myself concentrating on that more than anything else. It can be difficult to draw your eyes away from this flaw, so don't let any be visible. Make sure your clothes fit you well, but not too well. You don't want anything too tight or too short. Clothes that fit you poorly project the impression of sloppiness, and that's a sure kiss of death when you're giving a speech. People won't take you seriously, and that is your ultimate goal. Keep your head held high, looking people in the eye at all times. Always hold your gaze a second longer if you happen to make eye contact. Never look down and away if someone addresses you or is the slightest bit intimidating. This is a sign of weakness. Pay attention to this and eliminate this negative habit. Pay attention to your voice. Do you stutter in situations where there is the slightest bit of pressure? Or do you project a confident tone delivered slowly and smoothly? A weak voice is a certain sign of low self-esteem. Speak up and make yourself heard. When making a first impression, remember to smile. This helps your vibe become friendly, confident, and approachable. People are more likely to want to talk to you if they sense that they'll be received well. Focus on speaking at a moderate pace, with a well-modulated voice. Do not be afraid to enunciate properly. Using proper grammar when speaking and avoiding slang is expected if you are to make a good first impression. Remember, if people can't comprehend what you're saying, they will disregard you and your organization. Furthermore, be polite and courteous at all times. The greatest way to make a positive first impression is to demonstrate immediately that the audience, not you, is the center of action and conversation. Illustrate that the spotlight is on you only, and you'll miss opportunities. Show that you are others-centered, and they'll be more eager to hear what you're saying. You'll most likely be introduced by someone. While people are clapping furiously for you, stroll on stage with confidence and purpose, then acknowledge their applause and begin your speech. Part of the first impression you give occurs even before you are introduced to deliver your speech. As the audience arrives, your preparation should be concluded. You shouldn't have to study your speech. Instead, mingle with the audience and project that same friendly, confident attitude that will make your speech a success. When you speak, especially if you aren't well known to the audience, the most crucial part of your presentation is in the first few minutes. During that initial segment, the audience will be making critical judgments about you. Your listeners will decide whether you are confident, sincere, friendly, eager to address them, and worthy of their attention. In large measure, they will base this decision on what they see. After your introduction, walk purposefully and confidently to the speaking position. As you start speaking, don't just burst out with your words. Maintain the same voice level you will use throughout your speech, but be sure it is dynamic enough to get and hold your audience's attention. There may be times when you're called upon to make an impromptu speech. Don't panic. It can be done. Impromptu speaking. While many of us do not like to speak in front of people, there are times when we are asked to get up and say a few words about someone or a topic when we have not planned on saying anything at all. We are more shocked than anyone else. Has this ever happened to you? If and when this does happen to you, be prepared to rise to the challenge. Below are some tips that you can use the next time you are called on to speak. Take note that the following tips are also great ones to follow when giving a prepared speech, too. Decide quickly what your one message will be. Keep in mind that you have not been asked to give a speech, but to make some impromptu remarks. Hopefully, they have asked you early enough so that you can at least jot down a few notes before you speak. If not, pick one message or comment and focus on that one main idea. Many times, other ideas may come to you after you start speaking. If this happens, go with the flow and trust your instincts. Do not try and memorize what you'll say. Trying to memorize will only make you more nervous, and you'll find yourself thinking more about the words, not about the message. Start off strong and with confidence. If you at least plan your opening statement, this will get you started on the right foot. After all, just like with any formal speech, getting started is the most difficult. Plan what your first sentence will be. You may even write this opening line down on a note card and glance at it one more time just before you begin speaking. If you know you have 3 points or ideas to say, just start off simple by saying, "I would just like to talk about 3 points. The first point is, the second point is," and so on. Decide on your transitions from one point to the other. After you have decided on your opening remark or line, come up with a simple transition statement that takes you to your main point. If you have more than one point to make, you can use a natural transition such as "my second point is" or "my next point is," for instance. Just list on a note card or napkin what the main points or ideas will be. Do not write out the exact words, but just the points you want to mention. Maintain eye contact with the audience. This is easier to do if you do not write down all kinds of stuff to read. Look down at your next idea or thought and maintain eye contact with your audience and speak from your heart. Focus on communicating to your audience and not speaking at the crowd. Occasionally, throw in an off-the-cuff remark. Because you want your style to be flexible and seem impromptu, trust your instinct and add a few words which just pop into your head. Keep it conversational and think of the audience as a group of your friends. Finally, have a good conclusion. Gracefully just state, "and the last point I would like to make is," and once you've made your last point, you can then turn control back to the person who asked you to speak in the first place. With a little practice, this process will feel more natural to you. Anticipating that you may be asked to say a few words should force you to at least think about what you might say if you are asked. Then, if you are asked, you are better prepared because you anticipated being asked. This is much better than thinking they won't ask you, and they actually do. What else do you need to know? Not much, really. But we do have some additional tips to offer. In general, public speaking isn't a death sentence. It's a chance for you to tell other people something you know about and have a passion for. As we've said, even if you don't have a passion for your topic, act like you do. That can make the biggest difference of all. Be yourself during your speech. You are most effective when you are able to be yourself with the group. You may want to spend some time before you speak getting in touch with how you feel when you feel most yourself. Remembering how we feel at those times can often help us feel that way again. Many of us think that we'll be okay if we do a good job and please the audience. What is more likely to make us feel okay is to be who we are. This is also most likely to create a good connection with the audience. You don't need to be afraid of silence. Silences can help us center ourselves and give time for the audience to settle in. Silences can allow time for us to find the words to say. Silences can give the audience time to absorb what you have said. Silences can create emphasis and impact. Pause for several seconds before you begin speaking, making eye contact with two or three people before you begin. Take a breath or two and let yourself feel your feet connecting to the floor. You may want to consciously open your heart to the audience before you begin. Instead of feeling that you have to give the audience something, focus more on receiving their support. Paradoxically, if you are extremely nervous before you begin, focus on putting your audience at ease. You must focus on getting rid of distracting body language and mannerisms. Some common faults of inexperienced and ineffective speakers are gripping or leaning on the lectern, finger tapping, lip biting or licking, toying with coins or jewelry, frowning, adjusting hair or clothing, head wagging. These have two things in common. First, they are physical manifestations of simple nervousness, and they are performed unconsciously. That is why you need to make yourself aware of what you are doing while speaking. When you make a verbal mistake, you can easily correct it because you can hear your own words, but you can't see yourself, so most distracting mannerisms go uncorrected. You can't eliminate them unless you know they exist, so you should videotape yourself. After you have made a tape, watch it with a critical eye. The first step in eliminating any superfluous behavior is to obtain an accurate perception of your body's image. This should include posture, gestures, body movement, facial expressions, eye contact. The next step is to free yourself of physical behaviors that do not add to your speech. This can be accomplished by simply becoming aware of your problem areas. After you have videotaped yourself speaking, review the tape several times and make a list of all the distracting mannerisms you noticed. Review your tape the first time without looking for mannerisms. Just listen to the presentation as if you were hearing it for the first time and evaluating the overall impact you experienced from watching the tape. Review your tape a second time with the volume turned down and look for visual distractions. Take notes on what you observe. During a third review, have the picture turned off and listen only to your voice. Many people have never even heard a taping of their own voice before. Become accustomed to listening to your voice. Get to know it as others hear it. Note what you like and what you don't like. Pay attention to the speed, the volume, and the tone of your voice. Once you have made lists both of your distracting mannerisms and your more positive points, you are ready to have one or two family members watch the tape with you. Get their initial impression. Ask them to be honest. After you have completed these reviews, go over the list of all of the distracting mannerisms you saw and heard. The next time you are having a conversation with someone you know very well, try to notice whether you use any of these distracting mannerisms even in casual circumstances. Tackle each of your negative points one at a time. We did tell you the best way to build self-confidence is to be yourself. This is very true and stands to be repeated. The most important rule for making your body communicate effectively is to be yourself. The emphasis should be on the sharing of ideas, not on performance. Strive to be as genuine and natural as you are when you speak to family members and friends. Many people say, "I'm okay in a small group, but when I get in front of a larger group, I freeze." The only difference between speaking to a small, informal group and to a sizable audience is the number of listeners. To compensate for this, you need only to amplify your natural behavior. Be authentically yourself, but amplify your movements and expressions just enough so that the audience can see them. Effective communicators let their bodies mirror their feelings. That's why it's important to fall in love with your subject matter, because if you're bored by the topic, it will show through your body language, whether it's intentional or not. If you are interested in your subject, truly believe what you are saying, and want to share your message with others, your physical movements will come from within you and will be appropriate to what you're saying. By involving yourself in your message, you'll be natural and spontaneous without having to consciously think about what you are doing or saying. For many of us, this isn't as easy as it sounds because it requires us to drop the mask that shields the real self in public. To become an effective speaker, it is essential that you get rid of your mask and share your true feelings with your audience. Your audience wants to know how you feel about your subject. If you want to convince others, you must convey your convictions. Speak from the heart and to the soul. If you are prepared, your self-confidence will rise proportionately. Being fully prepared is the best way to ensure your success as a public speaker. Nothing influences a speaker's mental attitude more than the knowledge that he or she is thoroughly prepared. This knowledge leads to self-confidence, which is a vital ingredient of effective public speaking. How many of us have ever experienced a situation in which we had not prepared well for a presentation? How did we come across? On the other hand, think of those presentations that did go well. These are the ones that we had properly prepared for. Whenever you speak to people, make an extra effort to notice how you speak. Observe, too, whether the facial expressions of your listeners indicate they do or do not understand what you're saying. Another great way to build your self-confidence and preparation is to prepare a 90-second presentation about yourself. Describe who you are and what you do. Record your presentation and review it using the 4 steps described in the videotaping segment. Since you are talking about yourself, you don't need to research the topic. However, you do need to prepare what you're going to say and how you're going to say it. Plan everything, including your gestures and walking patterns. Use facial expressions wisely. Leave that deadpan expression to poker players. A speaker realizes that appropriate facial expressions are an important part of effective communication. In fact, facial expressions are often the key determinant of the meaning behind the message. People watch a speaker's face during the presentation. When you speak, your face, more clearly than any other part of your body, communicates to others your attitudes, feelings, and emotions. Remove expressions that don't belong on your face. Inappropriate expressions include distracting mannerisms or unconscious expressions not rooted in your feelings, attitudes, and emotions. In much the same way that some speakers perform random, distracting gestures and body movements, nervous speakers often release excessive energy and tension by unconsciously moving their facial muscles, licking their lips, tightening the jaw, etc. One type of unconscious facial movement which is less apt to be read clearly by an audience is involuntary frowning. This type of frowning occurs when a speaker attempts to deliver a memorized speech. There are no rules governing the use of specific expressions. If you relax your inhibitions and allow yourself to respond naturally to your thoughts, attitudes, and emotions, your facial expressions will be appropriate and will project sincerity, conviction, and credibility. The last section we have for you to consider is that of self-assessment. Judging your own performance. No matter how much applause or great feedback we get, the truth is that the only opinion that really counts is our own. While it's the meeting planner or conference organizer who pays us, invites us back, or refers us to others, we're still sometimes stuck with the weight of our own opinions. And as speakers, we're often really tough on ourselves. While there may be some among us who suffer from delusions of grandeur, there are far more speakers who suffer from delusions of insignificance. We often go over our past performances with a very critical eye. The truth is, we can't be objective about ourselves on the platform. The way we view our abilities depends on how clear our vision is. For many, it's clouded by misperceptions that end up holding us back. But how do we know whether our vision is clear or not? Here's an assessment form that helps make any critique more objective and tells speakers what areas of speaking they might need to work on. In a field where there are few tools to measure progress or to determine problem areas, this assessment is an invaluable guide to determining exactly where one's natural talents lie and where one needs to polish and practice. Check off any area that you feel you might need to work on. Put a star next to any item that you feel you've mastered. We start. Build rapport with organizer. Submit professionally designed material. Build rapport with audience. Dynamic opening that captures audience attention. Well-paced and smooth. Well-modulated voice. gripping material that holds audiences' attention. Well-practiced speech based on stories and acted with spontaneity rather than read or memorized. Authentic and personal use of humor, stories, and material. No borrowed stories or unattributed quotes. Fresh material. Genuine closing that touches or motivates audience members. Demonstrated professionalism. Appearance neat and clean. Conclusion. When you are called on to give a speech, it is a great honor for you both professionally and personally. While you may be initially afraid, start looking at speaking before an audience as an opportunity rather than a burden. It's up to you to take steps to learn how to both prepare your speech and deliver it so you will be enhancing your audience's time rather than wasting it. Consider the following. Mark Twain once attended a meeting in which one of the speakers was raising money. Twain, deeming the cause to be a worthy one, decided to donate $100. As the speaker droned on, however, he decided to cut his contribution in half. With no end in sight, Twain cut his intended offer again to $10. At last, the speaker finished and the collection basket was passed around. Twain's contribution? When the basket finally reached him, he removed a dollar and passed it along. Take these tips and put them to use. Great public speakers aren't born overnight. They are born through experience, along with trial and error. When you find something that works for you, hold on to it and put it to use over and over again. There's nothing quite as wonderful as the sound of an audience clapping for you after you delivered a great speech. Take what you know and put your heart into it. Then share it with others. Success is up to you. Be successful and enjoy the ride.